Hey everyone, it's JTB.
And this is Bogowski.
And welcome back to the Ninja Gaiden 2 Master Ninja Walkthrough. This is going to be Chapter 13. Another one, which I think is pretty underrated in terms of visuals. Like, this is cool. I think this is a great environment. Hopefully more people will get around to playing this now and they can see some of this stuff. So coming off Chapter 12, I mentioned about the Muramasa at the end of that chapter. I totally forgot that there is literally one right there. So... don't ignore what I said about this is the last Muramasa for quite a while. There is one literally at the start of this chapter. So, however, once you come in here, I don't think you can go out that door, the door that's behind you. So load up on items. Right at the start if you need to, because you've got quite a few fights here before you get to another one. The Marionettes are pretty much kind of free in this encounter because they don't seem to want to attack you. I don't know if it's because of the environment. It seems like when you fight these in like a round environment, like an open environment, they tend to do their drill dive and their lunge at you like crazy, whereas here they just kind of seem to move back and forth and don't really do a whole lot. So it's reasonably safe to just charge up UTs and take them out. You can use the scythe if you want to be really, really safe and just hang back, and you can just scythe UT them, no problem. It's going to be a pretty nice chunk of money as well. You can use the Windmill Shuriken as well, but sometimes that doesn't kill them, so it's a bit of a risk going for that, really.
Or you could spend hours in single-hit Kasarigami UT if you're going to play for karma.
Oh, you could, yeah. That reminds me, I'm going to have to check the forum. I'm going to check it right now, actually, because curious because I know Yah did like a really detailed write-up of the chapters, and I have a bad feeling that was on the old forum.
What, on Iberians?
Yeah,
yeah, we lost a lot of good information on that, so.
Yeah, it's a shame. One thing that's new, though, by the way, the guy at Farnham the Drunk has started doing some tutorials for NG2, so check out his channel. I'll try and remember to link that below. He's also got a no damage run on his channel, which is definitely worth checking out. There's a lot of good tech in those videos to show ways to get through it that way. He's a fantastic player. It's going to be not, you know, you don't have to go through it no damage just to get through it, but some of the strategies can definitely be applied to, you know, just playing normally. It doesn't look like it, no. I don't think we have still got that thread. That's a shame, because I know he did a write-up for a lot of the chapters, and he talked about how long it took him to farm, you know, some of these encounters, and you know, you're looking at hours, you know, just literally hours and hours spent here, you know, farming UTs. So it's reasonably straightforward to get your UT chain going. I got a bit greedy there, because I had staggered essence, so I wanted to try and take advantage of that. Fortunately, at this point in the game, I think I am still sitting on a couple of Life of the Thousand Gods, so I have still got a few life upgrades to put in. No more Test of Valors as of Chapter 11, so you haven't got to worry about them. And it's kind of why these chapters are so short, really. 12, 13, and 14 are pretty much just a couple of, you know, reasonably long fiend fights, and then the boss, and then that's pretty much it. So you just want to kind of minimize your items, maximize your item conservation, minimize item use, so to speak. So this is why these fights can go a bit... They can go bad super quick, you know. If you get a bit too aggressive, it only takes these a couple of hits to just tear through your health bar, so be careful. That was a great UT there, Ryu. So here we've got this weird bug. I think we have mentioned this, but if you can cut off, like, both arms of a marionette, and then they're alive, but Ryu won't ever target them with any moves. You know, like, strings will just go right through them. As you can see, like, that marionette wasn't actually dead, but you can't OT it, because I think it's probably some kind of bug, I would guess, in the system where the game is thinking, well, this enemy's missing two limbs, therefore they should be dead, so Ryu isn't going to target the enemy, but you still actually have to finish them off, you know, to kill them, which is a bit annoying. One of my favourite rooms in the whole game. You can just Windmill Shuriken UT these guys. It's so satisfying to just tear.
Or if you wanted a Nippo, you could pierce some void down there.
Yeah, we mentioned in Chapter 12, I believe, you can do it here. You can play bowling, little mini game. Like, how many guys can you take out with one piercing void? It's actually a lot of fun. It's really satisfying to, because it just makes a good noise when it goes through them. And level three piercing void, sorry, is just, yeah, it's going to rip through these guys like nothing.
Oh, that'd have been fun if you would have done it right there.
Oh yeah, this is actually a perfect time to do it. The reason I don't know is because I like to save it for the next upcoming room can actually be very, very hard if you get in a bad spot, because you have a ton of golden Vangelfs quite far away from you, and they will just start, I mean, chucking fireballs like it's popcorn all the way down, and their aim is incredibly good. Ryu could learn a thing or two from some of the enemies in this game.
Some of that aim. Oh wow, yeah. That one looked like it hit that guy and still went through him, I guess because of he was attacking.
His armor was activated, so he got through that. But you can't stop the Windmill Shuriken, man. It keeps going, and then it got the other one. So you can use Nimpo if you want, it's just you can't go back to that Muramasa, so I just like to save it for here. Because at this health bar, like, this looks like a decent amount of health. Like, one hit here into a fireball and I'm dead. So what did I get there? Two or three? Oh, yeah. He gave me a Nimpo orb, so that was that was always nice when you get a Nimpo. The hitbox on the Piercing Void, I feel, is a little bit deceptive. Like, the actual fireball itself is huge, but the hitbox is about the size of a Nimpo orb, an Essence Orb, sorry. Like, it doesn't have anywhere near, like how in NGB you've got level 3 Inferno, the fireball is gigantic, and, like, the hitbox is the entire thing. In this game, it's way, way smaller. I think it has the same sort of representative hitbox of level 1, but it's kind of hard to test, because you get that big circle to aim it, and it can be a bit wonky sometimes where it goes. Another reason to save some Nimpo is coming up here, these horsemen. Don't sleep on these. Like, these do tend to just kind of run up and down and let you charge for the most part, but if they land their grab on you, that's about a third of your life bar here. It really doesn't, you don't want to get hit by that.
I always felt that those first couple of fights were a little lazy. You know, the enemies really don't do anything. You know, they stand back and let you, at least these guys charge at you and attack. I was kind of disappointed with some of these later fights.
There's a weird thing in the game with that too, where it feels like, you know, when you get a load of ninjas in a fight, like if you get, like, say, you know, sometimes you have like 10 ninjas on screen at once, and they kind of still act like enemies, whereas when you get a lot of fiends, like when you get a lot of Vangelfs or a lot of marionettes or zombies, they just kind of stand there and they don't really do much. It's almost like they didn't get around, I guess, to, like, programming them so that they could function when there's a lot of them around, whereas, like, the ninjas, that doesn't affect them at all. It'd be kind of nice if the ninjas, you know, forgot how to attack you sometimes when there's a load of them around. So you got a bunch of ghostfish here. I can just kind of use these for health and Nimpo, really. It's weird. Ghostfish don't operate under the same kind of rules as they do in NGB, but I feel like it's so much easier to get them off you in this game, and they don't do nearly as much damage. So, in a way, they're kind of easier, even though they don't, you know, behave the same way. So I think there's an elixir herb, rather, in that chest. So if you wanted to, you could heal on the save statue and then get money. But with the fights before this, like, you should have got a pretty decent amount of money. So, like, right here, look, you know, there's, what, about 8 guys here on screen? And they're all attacking me. Like, you know, they're not, you know, half of them aren't, you know, just sitting around doing nothing. So you got some Fiend Mages here. As we said before, take out Fiend Mages straight away. And start up the good old Tonfa UT. Look at that guy. No head, no arms, one leg. He was still going. He was still going. Oh, I love the Tonfa's counterattacks. They're so... He's got real good punch to them. That's a great animation. I should have just left him there to play out that animation. He just kind of staggers and falls over. So... I'm going to say, why didn't I finish that string?
Yeah.
Oh, that's a good move. Garland drop, I think that's called, with the Tonfa. Again, amazing sound effect. Just really, really good. Like, you do feel really powerful in this game. They did a great job, I think, with the sound design of just making the moves feel like they really hit hard, you know. They've got a great sense of weight behind them. I think this might still be good. Yeah, I think it's going to sound, pretty sure this is still Ghostfish, so... be careful on there. So that was actually a really good example of getting very lucky with Nimpo. I think both sets of those ghostfish and the ninjas gave me Nimpo, so that refilled my Nimpo for free. Again, another cool environment. I like the... I feel like this
There's
game got a bit of a...
There's a skull up there, too, I think. I think that might be one of the last skulls.
Oh, okay. Yeah, I'm. Yeah, it's funny. Yeah. I could
You've
tell you.
You've already got them all, so.
Yeah, I've got them all here, but I could tell you where all 50 scarabs are any day of the week. I have no idea where all the skulls are in this game. it's a shame that they're kind of a one playthrough item. It would have been cool if they functioned similar to the scarabs. So one thing about these sacks that have the enemies in them, the really big fat ones will have a Rasetsu in them. So what you want to do is hit it like a couple of times with the Tomfer just to kind of weaken the sack a little bit, and then charge up the UT so that then like the first hit of the UT actually destroys it, and then the rest of the UT will start hitting the Rasetsu. That was really weird then, because it looked like he just survived an OT.
Right.
And then the game almost said, yo, dude, no, you're dead. Like, what are you doing? Like, stop cheating. So, it was a bit of a weird occurrence there. It's funny, playing this game a lot more recently, there's some really weird stuff like that I've been seeing lately. Like, just really bizarre inconsistencies in... You know, like you know, Ryu hitting people with OTs, UTs just like whiffing for no reason. Like, you'll literally hit a guy right in the face with a UT, and just nothing happens. It's really, really strange. I guess it's particularly jarring coming from NGB, because, granted, Ryu's not perfect in that game. But for the most part, you know, NGB is fairly solid. Like, you don't get that kind of stuff happen very. It's very rare for that to happen in NGB. Whereas in this game, it just seems to happen all the time. And with the damage the way it is on the enemies, like a UT just completely whiffing and not hitting anything, even though, like, you clearly hit something, it can put you in a really bad spot, you know?
I still laugh at their grabs. You know, they'll just grab you and kind of uppercut you or something. Whereas in NGB, you know, they grab you and cut your throat. I know I've mentioned it before, but it was just so brutal. And NGB and the kick and trip and knockdown and stab and you know, I felt that those moves were a lot more brutal than, oh, here, let me just grab your hand and slash you with my knife.
Can you imagine how annoying the military guys would have been in this game?
Oh yeah,
like,
yeah.
Then again, I suppose the TAC ninjas kind of take their place, don't they, in a way, because they've got machine guns and rocket launchers.
But it is frustrating whenever they, like, just stun lock you. That's pretty frustrating.
Yeah, I mean, the TAC ninjas in this game, they've definitely got some NGO4 DNA in them. Because in NGO4, man... and that happened on hit in NGO4, too. So, you know, if you got tagged by a machine gun in NGO4, they could then just... All three of them could just start shooting you. And they could just drain your health bar.
And
you had to nimpo out or something, so... that was pretty crazy. These little pods, whatever you want to call them, most of them, I think all of them, except the big ones, just have ninjas in them. So whenever you kind of, you know, whenever they drop down, like if you just have a rotate Y buffered with the Tonfa, more often than not, you'll either kill at least one. Sometimes you can take out all three of them just with one rotate Y. And then that's going to be a nice combo, so you know, you're going to build up a little bit of money here too. See, right there, look, that hit that ninja... That hit him, and yet just nothing. Nothing. Just absolute like that. The UT just stopped. It's really strange when that kind of stuff happens. So you saw there, these guys have the same, you know, I don't like my arm, so I'm just going to blow it up to hurt Ryu attack that the purple ones have. And that move is just extremely fast. It's one of those where you think, oh, I can see that coming, and then they just run up to you and just boom, and like, oh, okay, great. That was a third of my life bar. Okay, I didn't see that coming. So I think we covered the Rasetsus in chapter 10, I want to say, where you fight a bunch of them. We did mention about like how good the Tomfa are when they're one-on-one, because you can just do rotate Y, and then you can parry, well, not parry, but you know, you can counter-attack the string they do. And then you can just hit confirm that into YY forward Y to get the full damage, and then you can buffer another rotate Y. It's nuts, like, how fast you can take out a Rasetsu with the Tomfa. It's really, really good to use on them. You could, and of course, you can use the, what's it called? The rotate Y.
Good timing on your on landing, because 1 second earlier, yep, and all those explosions would have got you.
Yeah, and there's no... there is some damage protection from incendiaries. Like, if you've got, you know, say if you've got, like, 8 or 9 in you, and you'll only... It seems like you only take damage for, like, the first couple that explode, which is still a lot of damage, don't get me wrong. But it's not as bad as all of them hitting you. And we mentioned before, you know, you can use that to your advantage. You know, if you get knocked out of the air by an incendiary, you can come down with an on-landing move. And more often than not, you know, that's going to happen every now and then. So just keep an eye out for that. You know, if you think, okay, I'm probably not going to be able to get out of all of these incendiaries, but if I jump here, I can, you know, get tagged by one and I can come down with a UT. So, you know, you give up a little bit of health, but you can kill, you know, say 3 or 4 or even 5 enemies if you've got the Tonfa. So it's a pretty good trade in my book, really. You take a little bit of damage, but you kill, you know, half a dozen dudes.
I wonder what they were thinking of when they decided about the invincibility frames or invulnerability frames. You know, hey, we're going to throw 800 shurikens at you, but if somebody guillotine throws an enemy, they'll be okay. Or if somebody dashes just in the right time.
Yeah, I'm not sure they did. I'm not sure they... that was a great camera angle there on that. Probably dunked him on that last hit. I'm not sure they did. Someone made a good point on... I think it was the Chapter 2 video, about how, like, the iframes work, and he summed it up really well. Your name escapes me, I'm sorry. But he said, in this game, like, you can be invincible, but you're never truly invulnerable, like you are in NGB, and I thought that's a good way to put it, because, you know, incendiaries can't interrupt your UT, but they can still, like, stick you with them during the animation. Whereas in NGB, like, when you did a UT, you were you were untouchable. You know, nothing could touch right. you when you did a UT. So, just weird things like that. Maybe it was their attempt to try and balance it. There was a lot of talk around when this originally came out that it came out, like, 6 months early, apparently. It was always sort of rumor mill talk. You know, it was never really confirmed. But I do feel like there are things in the game, like how the ninjas behave, as opposed to the fiends. It feels like the ninjas behave properly when there's a lot of them, where the fiends kind of don't, you know? Like, when you fight a ton of Gargers, you only get, like, one or two attacking you at once. That said, if you had, like, 8 Gargers attacking you all at the same time, maybe that would be... maybe they didn't want to do that. So, I'd recommend saving that save statue. I think the ninja corpse here has health, and I think the chest here has health too. So you've got quite a lot of health to kind of, you know, cover you with this fight here. This is just a ton of gargoyles, so, you know, if you didn't want to fight it, you could just jump right down and fight, what's-his-face. But because you've got quite a bit of room to work with here, this fight's not too bad.
Are you changing up the OTs just so people can see them with different weapons? Just to do something different?
Yeah, pretty much. Say, at this point, this is like the... I'd say I haven't really been playing this chapter for money. Because at this point, you know, I feel like I've shown, you know, every enemy for money. So if you're fine on money, you can kind of just, you know, relax a little bit here and have a bit of fun. And I also love the flail OT on the Resetsu, the fact that he does a bit of the cremator string and just, you know, bang, 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 right. bang, bang. Just, oh, it's so good. It's funny. So I remember when the game came out, some people really didn't like the OT system. Like, that turned off a few people on the game. I gotta admit, I love it. I think it's awesome. I think it's...
I was just gonna say, if you know that's a Nimpo chest, you could also kind of just Inferno Nimpos some of these guys.
Yeah.
If you don't want to stand there shooting, if you're okay with the Nimpo. Yeah.
So you get a couple of guys sometimes... Okay, I think that might be a random ghost fish or something chest, because I could have swore that was a herb, not not ghost fish, so be careful when you open that one. But yeah, I know there was a few comments when it came out about, like, they were basically QuickTime events, and I think this game came out when, in general, like, people were so sick of QuickTime events, kind of yeah. understandably. But I felt like that was pretty... What's the word? That's not really understanding how the system works. You know, the delimming system and the OT system... I feel like this run, hopefully, has shown it. You know, it makes Ryu just incredibly powerful in the game. You know, the fact that you can do a string that, for the most part, is, you know, quite safe. It has a lot of priority. And then you can take an enemy that is, you know, usually a big threat to you. And you can do one string, cancel OT dead. You know, you can... It's not like... like in Devil May Cry, for example, the enemies in DMC on the higher difficulties just have buckets and buckets and buckets of health, you know, that you have to kind of whittle down. Whereas in this, I thought it was a nicer, like, it was a nice change for them to be like, okay, these are really, really dangerous enemies, and they have a lot of health. You know, if you just try and, like, string enemies, it takes a while. But if you know how to use, like, the right string and the OT system, you can take them out real fast. I like that. So I can't remember if I showed this loop in Chapter 4. There is a weird timing to it. I must admit, I have not got the timing down, like, 100%. Because apparently this is a guaranteed loop on him. If you just do X, hold down, Y, B, Y, Y, hold down, Y, B. Like, you can just shred his whole health bar and he won't even go into rage mode. Here's me forgetting that he dashes twice, like Genshin. So I get tagged a couple of times there. I know the main thing to remember about him when he starts, when he goes into, like, berserk mode, is... unfortunately, his dash doesn't always guarantee you a hit. Like, here, look, he's too far away for me to hit him. He's too far away. So you need to kind of use your dashes so you can get him to whiff next to you, and then he's still you're still guaranteed a hit there. But just keep an eye on, you know, his double dash and where he's going to end up.
Right, and also, if he's going to dash or be a little bit too far, don't start pushing some button thinking you're going to be getting some hits on him, because all of a sudden you're opening yourself up. And then he'll come back and just nail you.
And he packs a goddamn punch in this chapter. Right. His damage is buffed quite a bit from Chapter 4. So if you get tagged by a grab, it's about two-thirds of your life bar. So, you know, play it safe on Alexei. Alexei is one of the few bosses in the game where you can just kind of hang back and, you know, take your opportunities and you'll be fine. Yeah, that does it for this one, guys. Pretty short chapter. A great chapter is coming up, but not at the start, so we'll cover that when we when we get into chapter 14. But we're almost there. We're on the home stretch, guys, so we'll see you in the next video. Take care.
We'll see you. Take care.